long-awaited sacroiliacularis. Now, it's a bit of a minefield this. Let's see if we can make it as easy as possible. To begin with, sacroiliac joints, these little knobbly bits, how I assess them to start with is I come behind, and if I turn it around here, then you can see, I put my hands underneath the PSIS's, and then I'm just looking to see what's happened with the pelvis. Is there a rotation? Is there a torsion going on? So, if there's a torsion, a rotation to the left, we'll find the PSIS at the back of the left one going down, the ASIS at the front going up, and then the right one going down like this. So we get this torsion coming around as it rotates. Now, that doesn't mean that the sacroiliac joint is going to be unlocked if it stays wedged between the two, but it can mean that it's unlocked. So the first thing I do is I assess it in standing. So thanks to Diane Lee, she's changed my assessment a little bit with this. So I take the whole of my hand onto the ilium here, and I take my thumb just into this little notch here, and I place them in here, and I will just get my patient to shift weights onto the right leg, and as they put weight onto that right leg, I'm looking to see if in essence that ilium unlocks this way, to see if it just drops forwards. And then I do the same on the other side. So quite often you'll get a false positive if the sacroiliac joint is already unlocked in standing. So we're just looking at that to begin with before we do anything else. And then after that, we'll do the famous stalk test. Now Ben has only got one leg here, but for instance, I would do both sides. So if he was standing on his right leg, I would ask him to lift up his left knee. And for this one, I would have my hand on the left ilium and my thumb just in the little nozzle in there. And as the knee lifts up, I would expect to see that pelvis just drop down like this instead of hiking up. So then I would change the other leg, standing on the left leg, lifting up the right knee. As the right knee comes up, it's going to pull the ilium under and you will see it rotate back. So I'm looking, really, do they feel equal on both sides? Or is there a hitch on one? Or is it just a slight difference in feel between the two? And then I'll do the same thing, but I'll assess the standing leg this time. So the leg which is on the floor, as we lift the left knee, I'll assess this right one and see, does it unlock in single leg stance? Again, it's just telling me, why would normally look for this? If someone has pain around the back, particularly around the poles of the sacroiliac joint here, if it refers down into the buttocks, down the side of the leg, kind of like an ITB referral, or into the front of the groin, those are my usual go-tos for sacroiliac joint stuff there. So if I show you that with Manta, move Bendy out of the way, here we go, and how's the best way to see this? If you want to see Magda's bottom, I think that's probably a pretty good way. So to start with, I feel the little knobbly bits in here, and Magda's high up on the left one. I come round and I feel the knobbly bits at the front, and she's high on the left one as well. And she's also got a weight over her left leg, so she's actually shifted across like this in the stance. So if I bring her back round again, so we have a look to see what it feels like just in standing. So I guess just gently take weight into the right side and then just shift it back into the left, just to see if there's any change there. And I do that a couple of times just to get a feel. Left one feels good. Then we go into the right one and we shift over to the right and back. It's literally just a shift of weight. It's not a big movement, and that feels pretty good to me. And then if I was holding on to the right ilium, I'd say make lift up your left knee. It doesn't feel too bad on that leg, and I get to do that a couple of times. And then change legs and lift up the right leg. Again, doesn't feel too bad. And then we'll come back onto the right side, and then this time I'll get her to lift up her right knee. Right knee comes up. I'm looking to see if my right thumb starts to drop down. I should do that a couple of times. And then we change it to the other leg. And we do it a couple of times on that. Now, a lot of the arguments out there are, Are we actually able to have different testers coming in and reliably do the same test and come up with the same results? And there are so many variables in that. It's actually really interesting to look into that. But I think if as one person you can do the test three times and come up with the same results, then actually your reliability as a practitioner is pretty good. So then it gives you something to assess and reassess. Otherwise, we've got no way of actually coming in treating the sacroiliac joints in the first place. So now we're down on the couch, and what I'm going to do to assess the sacroiliac joints through palpation is I'm going to try and get the pelvis level and derotate it first. So at least that way I know I'm assessing like for like through that sacroiliac joint. So with Magda here, she's got a slight rotation to the right in her pelvis. So if I just bring her knee up a little bit, and bring it down a little bit, probably sort of out there. I'm going to find the sweet spot so you can get the pelvis balanced. But for now, I'm going to bring it down so you can see a little bit better. And actually, I'm going to try and do it over the top. I normally do it over the side that I'm working on. So, left hand is going to come back. It's just going to move this hand out of the way so you can see. I take my hand underneath onto where, I think you can see I'm bendy here. We've got the ilium joining into the sacrum. So let's place my hands along that line. Like so, but obviously from the other side. And I take my top hand, and you've got the ASIS at the front. So to start with my fingers on the sacrum underneath on this hand, I gently shear down. And it's not a big movement, just to see as I go down whether I can move that ilium just over the top of the sacrum. So that's the middle bit. Then I come slightly up and I put more pressure towards the top. Check the top pole of the sacrum and the ilium, and then slightly down to get the lower pole. And the lovely Diane suggests that probably more medial, you're looking at piriformis as being a muscle which might stop that movement. If you go up a little bit higher, kind of the erect spinae, the mortifidi, and a little bit lower, we go into ischiococcygeus. So all muscles which any good palpate and release. So once we've come into that, we've got a couple of options afterwards, and one of them is to see if the joint is really, really mobile. So if the compared size of one side is incredibly mobile, I want to see if by locking up the actual joints, putting the bones into the right position. So with this, if we have a look at the sacrum here, if I was to just posteriorly tilt the pelvis a bit, I'd actually cause the bones to lock. That would be its most stable position. So I'm going to see if the joint's actually got the ligamentous capacity to hold itself. So what I would do is I would bring either that sacrum under, or I would posteriorly tilt that ilium. And then I would do the same shearing to see, actually, does the joint now feel locked? If it does, that's a great thing. If it doesn't, I would go in and I would see if we can use muscle contraction to stabilize it. So we could cue Magda to contract our multifidus muscles a little bit, TVA a little bit, pelvic floor, just to see if we can use muscles to stabilize that joint. And if the ligamentous capacity wasn't there, we'd use the muscular up training to see then if we could get stability back through those joints again. The last thing is I would check for possible joints, what would you call it, fixation possibly, a really articular kind of stuck joints. So for that I would usually release the muscles around there first, see what happened with the joint. If the joint is still sitting there really locked up and there's no other way that I could to get it out, I would start to articulate that. So if I do it on this side, I would take the knee up, place my hand underneath like I did before. I'd internally rotate that hip, slightly take it across the body into a bit of adduction, and then just use it to come down on, just to see if I could shear that ilium over top of the sacrum to get it moving that way, and then reassess from There.
There's loads to go with the sacroiliac joints. We can start looking at muscle contraction, leg lifts. One thing I do like to do, and again, this is from Diane, is ask my patient to lift their leg up an inch or so, and then the other one up an inch or so, and see which one is harder to do as well. Whether the pelvis starts to rock on one side, whether it actually feels tougher to lift one leg up. And then I derotate the pelvis, and I either help closure at the front by just compressing lightly in. So derotate, compress the pubic symphysis, and then ask them to lift the leg up again an inch or so, see if that makes it easier. And the other one to do is derotate and then compress at the back and get closure at the back and lift the leg a little bit. And if I get change from that, then I know that actually if I can get that pelvis to derotate a little bit and get some good closure, either at the front or the back, so the muscles, which would do that, then we can actually get a joint which is more stable and the muscles which help move the femur within the pelvis can work a little bit better, which isn't actually always in the hip. Then we would chase from toe all the way back up to the head. So in a nutshell, that's the sacroiliac joint. It's complicated and it also takes a little bit of palpation in there as well. But really, really useful, I found, skill set, particularly on myself, to be able to figure out where things are coming from. I found working up on my skull actually allowed the muscles and everything around the hip to start to stabilize. So then you can reassess that palpation and feel a very definite change in there as well. So yeah, sacroiliac joints in a nutshell. Next time, we're gonna move on up into the lumbar spine.